Hello everyone, in this video I will explain how to conduct data analysis process systematically. Data analysis is a scientific process involving repeatable and organized tasks. You need to systematically perform a series of activities during each task, such as data acquisition, cleaning, outlier or missing value detection, scaling and transformation, and so on and so forth. Here is the outline of my talk. I will start with initial analysis and then pass to exploratory data analysis, dimensionality reduction, experimental design, modeling, evaluation, improving the model, and conclusions. Initial and exploratory analysis are the two very important tasks. Usually these tasks are more time consuming than the modeling task. Okay, let's start with initial analysis. I prefer to separate this task into three activities: univariate analysis, bivariate analysis, and multivariate analysis. In univariate analysis, we take one variable at a time and do our analysis. In case of bivariate analysis, we'll look for pairwise relations. However, in multivariate analysis, we'll look for relations between more than two variables. In univariate analysis, first of all, we'll list all our variables and understand them one by one. We may be given a data dictionary, but still I strongly recommend you to go over the meaning of each variable and understand what each variable represents. We need to prepare a detailed data dictionary and ask questions such as, what is the source of this variable? Is it directly measured or is it calculated based on other variables? Does this variable have time associated with it? Getting the answers of these questions from the domain experts will help us to understand our data set better. Then we decide on the target variable, the variable that we want to predict. The remaining will be the input variables, and our target variable will be our output variable. Assigning the correct data types and appropriate column names is the next activity. All the variables should be assigned to the correct data type, like numeric, categorical, etc. For numeric attributes, we check the five number summary, minimum, mean, maximum, first and third quartile. Checking the levels and frequency tables of the categorical variables should also be done at this step. We can also check the names of the columns and put suitable column names for the variables. Each column will represent one variable, one attribute, such as age, height, weight. And each different observation should go to a different role. The dataset may contain duplicates, right? It may even have some errors, inconsistencies. An age variable with negative entries, let's say. A gender variable is given as male, female for some entries, and for others, it's as uppercase M and uppercase F. Later on, while doing analysis, it will be treated as four different factors, which is incorrect. We should also check the upper and lower cases. We need to keep either upper or lower case. We also check the blank spaces in the strings or character entries. So we need to fix these problems in this activity. The dataset may have missing values. Many data analysis tools do not accept missing data when training the models. So cases with missing values are thrown completely. And in such a case, we lose information. This can cause bias when systematic relationships between the missing data and predicted variable exist. The approaches in dealing with missing data can be to replace the missing value with a mean, median, mode, or a specific value. We should also note that when the missing data for a variable is all replaced with one value, this reduces the variance, can also affect correlation. Another approach may be predicting the missing value. An algorithm such as k-nearest neighbors may be used to impute the missing value with the value which is most like the case containing a missing case. When it comes to outliers, I may say that it is a tricky problem. Many graphs can highlight outliers such as box plots. Once the outliers are found, what are we going to do about them? The answer of this question depends on the project and the cause of the outlier. First, we need to determine what caused the outlier. Does the outlier appear to be a data entry error? For example, a decimal point was missed while typing. Or we may have some entries which do not belong to that data set or to that project. Causes that do not belong to that project should be removed completely. On the other hand, outliers do not equal errors. So we should detect the outliers, but we do not need to remove them. To decide on what to do about the outliers should be done at this stage. Categorical variables with too many levels can pull down the performance of our model. Both for predictions of regression and classification problems, categorical variables with many levels may cause some problems. During the univariate analysis, we should decide on how we will be treating them. There are some tools or methods to combine the levels of such categorical variables to have less levels. So at this step, we know that we have consistent data ready for further analysis. And then we check the distributions of the variables. Are they normally distributed? Low variance filter is another important issue that we need to check. We may have some attributes which has very low variance. For example, think that we have a homework grade where all the students got full marks. This homework will not be able to distinguish the students from one another. If we have an attribute which has close to zero variance, we should know that at this step of our analysis. How about the dependent variable, our target variable? The distribution of the target variable is something we should check as well. Say you have a binary dependent variable and 90% of it is assigned as 1 and the rest as 0. This means that you have an imbalanced data set. If you run a machine learning algorithm on an imbalanced data, your model will have much more examples from the majority class and this will cause problems. At this stage, we will know whether we have an imbalanced data or not. Time variables should be considered separately. How are the time variables collected? Are they discrete or continuous? What is the range of the data collection? Do we have years, months, or days? How are we going to analyze them? Are we going to check some trends or seasonality in the data set? Do we need to go to a time series analysis? So we don't do these analyses during the initial analysis step. If we check the time variables separately, we will have an idea for the further steps. And then visualizations. Visualizations are very important and nowadays it becomes even more important, especially in our presentations, reports, and research papers. It's very important to come up with stories and visualize those stories. The ones that we choose to report should have a story, should tell something interesting about our dataset. The next step is bivariate analysis. In bivariate analysis, we go to pairwise relations. Relations between the input variables and as well as the relations between the input and the output variable. For pairwise visualizations, scatter plots are very useful. Correlation analysis also needs to be considered at this stage. Depending on the type of our variables, we can go to Spearman or Pearson. And strongly correlated attributes are important as well. Say if you have two very strongly correlated attributes, we can remove one of them, right? But while removing one of them, I usually choose the one which has low variance or the one which was having more missing values in the beginning of the analysis. The last step of initial analysis is multivariate analysis. This time, we check the multivariate relations. This stage can give some stories about the data set, stories of the actual data set, no inferences, no conclusions or no predictions yet. Remember, we're still doing initial analysis. This is also the stage that some advanced statistical tools are used. For example, you may have some groups in the data set that you want to investigate. One-way analysis of variance or the rank equivalent form, the Kruskal-Wallis test can be used to compare the means of some groups in the data set. Next stage is exploratory data analysis. I prefer to start with normalizing. Especially some machine learning algorithms which are using distance measures need to be normalized. So scaling the data set is done at this stage. Exploratory analysis is the step where you are really exploring your data set in depth. You may want to come up with interesting stories. I prefer to do some subsetting of the data at this stage. For example, for a specific disease, you want to explore the patients who have that disease. You can subset your data for those specific patients to find some interesting facts about that disease. Checking the subsequences can give us some more stories. And decision rules, association rules, n-grams are perfect tools to come up with systematic subsequences. Clustering analysis is also done at this step. For example, algorithms like k-means clustering group a set of objects in such a way that objects in the same group are more similar to each other than to those in other groups. Next task is dimensionality reduction. Actually, we have done some primitive dimensionality reduction during our previous stages. By removing the data columns with too many missing values, or removing an attribute with almost zero variance, or reducing the highly correlated columns, we already did some dimensionality reduction. But in this activity, I focus on numerous advanced tools. Dimensional reduction will have two activities, feature selection and feature extraction. Feature selection is a stage where we decide on the importance of the attributes. Statistical measures like information gain or Gini index may be used for feature selection. Forward selection and backward elimination are also widely used for feature selection. After feature selection techniques, we know which attributes will be important in our prediction model. We may see that we still have many attributes and we don't want to discard them unknowingly. There comes the tools for feature extraction. During this stage, instead of discarding an attribute, we reduce the dimension by transforming the attributes. Principal component analysis and linear discriminant analysis are commonly used dimensionality reduction techniques. After dimensionality reduction, now we are ready to do some modeling, and to go to modeling, we need to decide on our experimental design. Before using a machine learning algorithm, we will split the data set into training and test sets, right? But how are we going to do this splitting? Are we going to use some traditional experimental design, or are we going to use an approach like concept drift? If the target variable changes over time in unforeseen ways, concept drift approach may be needed. Another question is, do we have an imbalance in our data set? Remember, we checked that during the initial analysis. If yes, we need some treatments for this imbalance. Undersampling the majority class and oversampling the minority class are commonly used approaches. I also strongly recommend to do some cross-validation. Most of the time we use tenfold cross-validation. We may also need to use some bootstrapping resampling in some projects. And then comes modeling. Yes, now we are ready to run our machine learning algorithms. Depending on our research question, our model can be a classification or a regression model. Are we going to use decision trees or regression trees? Are we going to use logistic regression as a classifier or a regressor? For instance, if our research question was classification and if our data set was linear, we could go to algorithms like linear logistic regression or naive Bayes. If we have non-linearity, we can go with algorithms like decision trees, random forests, or k-nearest neighbors. Support vector meshes can be linear or non-linear depending on the kernel that we are choosing. Distance and similarity measures also need some attention. Are we using a distance measure like Euclidean measure or Manhattan measure or any other? Is it a similarity measure like cosine similarity? These are the issues we clarify, and then we run our models. After running our machine learning algorithms, we need to evaluate them, right? If it is a regression problem, we can use R-squared goodness of fit or AIC or RMSE. If it is a classification, we can go to confusion matrices and then evaluate the accuracy, recall, and precision. We can go to ROC curves, which are commonly used. And while we are comparing the performance of different algorithms, contingency tables, multivariate analysis of variance may be some tools that we can use. The next step is how we can improve our model, right? Improving our model is important as well. We may have very high accuracy, which can be a trouble. We may have very low accuracy, which can be a trouble. A model which had very high accuracy may have some problems like fixation variables, which means that some variables are doing very well in the prediction, but when we exclude them, the model is not performing well. We may have overfitting problems. Remember, decision tree-based algorithms may have that overfitting problems. Very low accuracy may tell us that the attributes we have does not have much predictive value. Like we may need more new variables, or we may need more observations. At this stage, I also want to mention that data analysis process is an iterative process. To arrive to a decision, we may need to repeat some rounds of our analysis. Say you need some new variables, and after evaluation, you need to go to initial analysis. There can be some cases that after performance evaluations, you go to exploratory data analysis because you need a deeper exploratory analysis. Conclusions is the final step in data analysis. We come up with inferences. I prefer to discuss threats to validity at this step as well. And to discuss the threats to validity under the steps of internal, external, and construct validity will give us a more technical discussion. We should also add the solutions we propose to reduce the effects of these threats. At the conclusion step, we can also discuss the next steps or further studies that we have planned for this current data analysis project. These were the steps that I wanted to share with you. I hope you conduct data analysis process systematically by using these steps. Thank you very much for your attention.